Hey everybody, Josh Tully from The Josh Tully Show. What you are about to see is absolutely amazing. We're about to have a conversation with a young man who was dead for about an hour. And yeah, I'm serious. This story is captivating the world right now. It is a great selling book. It's going to be turned into a movie for next Christmas season. But listen to this interview and I promise you, you are going to get chills down your spine. And I urge you to share this video with other people. It is an amazing story of a young man who came back from death's door, as well as the people who surrounded him and witnessed the entire thing. And the hearts that it's changing is just nothing short of a miracle. Enjoy. We have a really interesting interview for you today. We do a lot of stuff in politics and current events and business, but I think this interview is going to absolutely captivate you. You're going to want to share this with everybody else you know. So I just want to get right to it. Joining me right now, we have John and Joy Smith. You guys have probably one of the most captivating stories that I've ever heard. And I want to start with the story itself before how did we capture it into a book. So can you tell us how this all began?
On January 18th, 2015, I had a basketball game. And it was just a normal Saturday middle school basketball game. But it was a win that we needed as a team. We were having a very bad season, and you know, you want to win a game. So that was our goal. And throughout this whole game, the score was just so close, you know, 10-10, 15-15, 20-20. Until finally, we got a rebound, they gave me the ball, and I ran it up for a layup, and we won the game. So it's just a celebration type thing. But it was a longer weekend, so we wanted to hang out, me, Josh Rieger, and Josh Sander. And they were nagging Mom on, you know, can we go? I'd love to go hang out. So Mom finally caved in and said yes.
Okay.
So we were at Josh Rieger's house, and it's just a normal what we were doing, playing Xbox, eating pizza, hanging out, listening to music, you know. And then finally, we got bored. So near Josh Rieger's house is a local park, and we went up there, and they had this little merry-go-round, and we wanted to see who was the first one to throw up, pass out, gets the first headache, and so on. But eventually we got bored with that, and we noticed that the lake was frozen. So we decided that we would get the biggest rock we could, that all three of us could carry, and take it down to the dock and just drop it. And we noticed that the rock stayed. It didn't go all the way through. It just like put, like you could tell the rock was there, it was flat, but the rock was all the way down. So then we were sitting on the dock and we put our feet and moved them back and forth. And the third thing we did was turned our body and put our hands on the dock and did the same thing.
Okay.
Now I cannot remember who was the first one to stand up on the ice, but eventually all three of us got on there. Now the night before was the iconic picture of the three of us in I was wearing an Under Armour sleeveless shirt. We were all, you know, in our basketball gear. It was very, it wasn't warm, but it wasn't cold. So we didn't have jackets or hoodies or anything. So finally we went back to the house and we continued to play video games and we continued to, you know, eat and so forth and finally went to bed. The next morning we had a big breakfast, but we decided to take Josh Rieger's sister, Jamie, with us.
Okay.
We all ended up back on the ice again, except Jamie. Jamie didn't want to do it. And if you know me, I love the game of basketball. And when I talk on the phone, I walk. It's something that I picked up from my brothers.
Yeah, me too, actually.
Yeah. So Mom called me and asked me if I wanted to go to the local recreational place to work out and get shots up. And I was like, of course. So Mom finally said, I love you. And I said, I love you too. And as I hang up, the ice starts to crack and the three of us fall in. Me and Josh Rieger are about 25 to 50 feet out.
Okay.
And Josh Sander is near the dock, and Jamie is on the dock panicking for the three of us. Josh Sander self-rescued, and me and Josh Rieger are out fighting for our lives. Now, something that the paramedics told me and what Josh Rieger told me himself is that I was pushing ice up for him to stay afloat. But the problem was is that any time we'd put our hands on the ice, it would break. Mm. The ice would cut us, the water was starting to burn, and finally he told me after all of this was all done, the media kind of calmed down. He said, brother, I was expecting you to come back up, but you didn't. And people always ask me, what do you remember? And this is the best thing I can tell people, is that when you're in a pool and, you know, you're looking at the water and how it's moving and you can see how it's below and then above the surface and mm-hmm. underneath, that's the last thing I remember until I woke up a few days later. But
so you go out, you're under, the paramedics come and rescue you. What do they do to you? And obviously it's recounting, but what happens at that point? How long were you in the water?
15 to 16 minutes. We can pinpoint that pretty accurately from the 911 calls and when they pulled John out of the water. The first 911 call was at 11:32. I hung up with talking to him at 11:27. So between 11:27 and 11:32, he went in the water. All three of them did. 11:35, they had the second call. At that point in time, he'd gone down, and they didn't pull him out of the water till 11:51.
So when they pull you out, you're dead?
Yes. I'm blue, and they, you know, they do their all medical procedures, and they said when they, you know, tried to get the water out of my lungs that it was like a waterfall. Like water was just flushing out of my body and just coming out everywhere.
They take you then where? What happens to your then body? What happens to the body?
I'm transferred to St. Joe's West.
Okay.
They even tell you it was like a flash when they got me. When they saw my white shirt, it wasn't chaos, but it was like we have to go. It's like the clock was ticking. So they pulled me out, they got me, you know, nothing would stick to my body because I'm gray. I have snot sickles, hair sickles, everything, all of the above. And they just didn't know, you know, how to like get me there. So they immediately transferred me to St. Joe's West. And Mom knows it a little better than I do, so I'll let her take over.
So does he have any sign of life at this point?
Or no.
None?
No heart. But when I got the call from Josh's mom, Cindy, I was expecting her telephone call because we were going to transfer kids, you know. I was meeting her. So when she called, she said, I could tell by her voice something was wrong. And I said, are you okay? And she said, no, we've had an accident. I thought she meant a car accident. I said, you okay? And she goes, well, no, they've just pulled John out of the lake and he doesn't have a heartbeat. I mean, that's first wow. I hear. So when they pulled him out, he was basically lifeless, nothing. They were getting nothing from him at all.
Did they have any sign of life by the time they got him to the hospital?
No.
So still dead?
No. They did CPR. Well, they intubated him on shore, which is a new technique they were doing. They put it thinking that would help. Doing everything they could on shore, they were getting nothing. So that's when they decided they were going to rush him then on the hospital, which was about 5 minutes away. And so they took him to the hospital, and the charge nurse we've since met, Alex Giddens, she said when she opened up the ambulance, Jeremy, who was the chief of paramedics there, Halra, he was sitting at the head of the bed, and she said he was just in shock, and he kept saying, there's just so much water in his lungs. I can't believe how much water is in his lungs. And so they pulled him in and started working on him. They put what they call a bear hugger on him, because his core temperature at that time was only 88 degrees. His pH levels were 6.6. Nothing under 6.8 is considered survivable. And they started working on him for 27 minutes. They gave him CPR at the hospital.
Wow.
This is after being, you know, he's in the water for 15 minutes, probably on the shore for another 10 minutes.
In the ambulance.
In the ambulance, another five, and then in the hospital for 27 minutes. And I hadn't arrived at the hospital yet, but Alex told us that she was at the end of, they were at the end of everything that they could possibly do. And they have a saying with the doctors when you have something like this, that you're not dead until you're warm and dead. So they had warmed his body up to 96 degrees, and she had turned to Dr. Sutter, who wasn't even supposed to be in charge of him that day. He's an adult physician. They had a pediatric nurse there, or a doctor, and when she saw him, she goes, he's basically an adult. I need someone else. So they brought him over. We didn't know at that time that his daughter was in John's class. I mean, these things, the way they roll together is just amazing. But anyway, she turned to Dr. Sutter and said, Alex did, she said, what do I do? And he said, we give you five more minutes and then we're going to call time of death. And so at that time they heard that I was in the hospital, had arrived at the hospital, and they let me come back and sit, and they wanted to see, let me see that they had done everything they could for John and watch a little bit of the CPR, which is just brutal to watch. And I might add, the gentleman that was doing CPR was about 6'7", huge young man, and he was working furiously on John. And usually when they do CPR, there's broken bones or broken ribs, or, you know, because it's such a vicious thing that they do. John had no broken bones, no bruised bones, anything. Yet,
wow.
You know, through this, it's just amazing. But anyway, they sure. called me back, and so Dr. Sutter came over and knelt down next to me. He said, so you can go up and talk to John.
Well, let's pause here, because okay. we have to take a break anyway.
Sure.
But at this point, it looks like all hope is lost.
Yes.
So we'll pick up the story right after this.
Okay.
The paramedics that brought him in said he'd been down for 15 to 20 minutes. It was very grim. No, we didn't have any hope for him. I mean, we're going to do our best.
Even in the cases that I've seen where we do our advanced cardiac life support and give them epinephrine and shock arrhythmias, after that length of time, all I ever see is somebody that goes from dying in the ER to dying in an ICU. I was at the end of what I could offer medically.
All right, if you're just joining us, we're talking to John and Joy Smith. At this point in the story, John has been dead for approximately an hour, and you're at the hospital. They really can't do much. They brought his body temperature up, still no signs of life, still doing CPR. Then what happens?
Dr. Sutter said, Joyce, you can go up and talk to your son. And at that time, I didn't realize that they were going to call time of death and he was letting me say goodbye. I mean, that didn't even cross my mind, because on the way to the hospital, I was praying. I was being very intense with God. And I just had an assurance that God was not going to let this go, that he was not going to take my son. We adopted John 14 years before that, and we prayed for him for 17 years, and I just knew that God wasn't going to take him away from me. And so I went up to the end of the bed, and I started praying. We'd been doing a Bible study at church with Beth Moore's Believing God. And each day when you're doing your homework, there's a part in there you started out with, I believe God is who he says he is. I believe God can do what he says he can do, and I'm believing God. That's your confession that you're making every morning, your affirmation. And I was just going to stand on God's word. He either was God or he wasn't. You know, that was my mindset at that time. And so I'd heard this throughout my whole entire life, the Holy Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead. I thought, that's where I'm going. And so I started what I thought was a quiet prayer, but I've been told that everybody in the emergency room could hear me as I was crying out, God, please give me back my son. Send your Holy Spirit to restore my son's life. And within moments, Alex, who was the charge nurse there, who'd had her finger on a pulse for 27 minutes, she said she was so stunned, she starts feeling a pulse. She goes, I have a pulse. I have a pulse. I have a pulse. You know, if you could just tell the shock in her voice, you know, for 27 minutes she's had nothing, and all of a sudden, and then other people are saying, we have a pulse too, we have a pulse too. And so when I heard that, to me, it was done. God had taken care of the issue. Not so much for the doctors. That wasn't their view. Dr. Sutter would go on to say later in interviews, he thought he was just going to put John on a transport helicopter to move someplace else to die. But that wasn't God's plans. And it's amazing, because when I walked into the room, you know, people have asked us, did John see heaven? Was
yeah.
he? But that wasn't the purpose. That wasn't God's plan for this. When that happens, it's a one-person encounter. Mm-hmm. This story, I believe, God put out there so that everyone that hears and encounters this story has their own encounter with God, no matter where they are. We've had people come to us and say, oh, I want to tell you what your story means to us, because fill in the blank was going on in my life at this point in time, yeah. and this just turned me around. And it was the same thing. And when I walked in the room, that emergency room that day, there was no less than 25 hospital employees there, that God had set a platform to say, okay, once you've finished everything you've done, then I'll show you what I can do.
Wow.
So,
wow. So obviously you come back to life, you're sitting here now. How long were you out though? Because you said when I woke up. So how long were you out?
How many days was that long?
Well, it's, he didn't wake up until to commute or to, commute. You know, where,
but
where
I had,
he could.
I had certain days, like my eyes would open.
Okay.
Pastor Jason will fill in a very key story to when their prayers actually, you know, lifted and I lifted and I opened my eyes. I mean, just the prayers that everybody had, you know, didn't just help me, but they helped the community as well. I mean, we had a huge prayer chain going on during this process. But to answer your question, there were a few certain times that I'd open my eyes to certain people. But the first time I remember was how many days?
It was 10 days later. And the reason for that, he was on propofol for 10 days to keep him quiet and in a, you know, a medically induced coma while his body could catch up with what was going on. But what he woke up, and there's a timeline with this that is just, to me, is phenomenal. He woke up on the third day.
Wow.
On the third day, he woke up. He went in on Monday, he woke up on Wednesday morning, and we were sitting in the room, and all of a sudden we see his eyes start to flutter, and I said to the people, we had about eight people in the room, and I said, oh my goodness, look, he's opening up his eyes, again, still on propofol, and so he starts looking around the room, and he sees my brother-in-law, who he's very close to, and as soon as he latched eyes onto John, it was just locked there. You knew there was recognition. When he went into the hospital on Monday and they evaluated him, Dr. Garrett came to us and he said, okay, I want to know, you know, he said, I have good news and bad news. What do you want to hear first? And I told him, I said, I'm a bottom line girl. I want to hear, let's hear it. He said, your son was without oxygen for over an hour. He said, right now he has no brain function. He has brain stem function, which is very rudimentary, only to kind of sustain life, but it's what happens as you're preparing to die. And he said, we don't have any hope for this, and you know, how far do you want us to go? At that point in time, I was livid because he wasn't on the same page with me.
Right.
I knew God had healed my son, and he needed to catch up with that, and so I'd heard all I wanted to hear. So I got up, and I stood very close to him, and I said, here's the deal. I hear you're the very best at what you do. So I want you to do your very best and God will take care of the rest of this. And I said, there'll be absolutely no negative talk. I said, you will not say this kind of stuff in his room. I said, this will not be spoken over him. And he just kind of was like deer caught in headlights. And I walked out of the room. But to go back to where we were, then John's opening up his eyes and he's looking around the room. And for a child that has no brain activity, he is now showing recognition to people as he's seen. My brother-in-law gets up and walks to the end of the bed and his eyes are totally locked on him. So by this time, everybody in the room's crying. But and he, Dr. Garrett comes in and he sees what's going on and he does a basketball examination on John because John would not communicate with him. And Pastor Jason said, ask him about basketball. And so he started doing this LeBron James, Michael Jordan thing, and John was answering appropriately. And finally he stopped and he looked at John. He goes, John, do you understand what a miracle is? And John shook his head. He says, well, son, you're a miracle. And so to go on with the timeline, it was like on the third day he woke up. 7 days later, they took his ventilator, took him off the ventilator, moved us to a transitional floor, and 7 days later, we walked out of the hospital, literally walked out of the hospital. He wasn't in a wheelchair.
Wow.
Chair. He literally walked out of the hospital.
That's
and
amazing.
And 40 days from the day he woke up, he was released from all doctors.
40 days, huh?
So just that godly timeline.
Yeah, exactly. So obviously, everybody asks you, and you've mentioned that, but I got to ask you too, do you remember anything?
From the accident or from being in the hospital?
From being dead, from being in the coma. Did you have any sense of awareness at all?
From the accident, I remember, you know, what I told you about the water.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the screams, of course. These all came in nightmares later on. You know, the devil was just trying to bring me down.
Sure.
You know, get me to, you know, not believe in it. And that was a rough period. But with the prayers of my family and this church behind me, that the devil just, he will never win. So that all was erased and everything was good. But I had those regarding the screams of, I don't want to die. You know, I can kind of remember the burning sensation. I still have scars today of it. But to answer your question of regarding the hospital, I remember seeing kind of one of my old pastors, Pastor Mark, my uncle, Don, a good family friend, Ariana Fisher. I remember seeing her. And then, you know, kind of glimpses of, like, the doctors, people walking in and out in the actual room.
Well, let's take a break here, because obviously your scars to me represent a reminder to you that you've been resurrected. I would wear those scars with pride, to be honest. But when we come back, I want to talk about how this might have affected your faith. And we'll do that right after this.
I was waiting for the mother to come in.
I watched them as they were working on John, a very tall young man. And he was working, you could see the stress on his face, and he was working so hard on John, and they kept saying, no pulse, no pulse, no pulse. And finally, Dr. Sutter told me, he said, you can go up to the bed. And I remember walking up to the end of the bed and getting a hold of John's feet, which was uncovered and cold. And I started praying, dear God, send your Holy Spirit to just fill his life and give him breath.
I don't think I can emphasize it enough. This wasn't just somebody saying, please God, bring my son back. She was screaming. You could hear it down the hall. She was yelling at God. And when she did that, it was just, the evidence is there.
It was moments later, I heard them say, and I don't even know who said it, we've got a pulse, we've got a pulse. And I was like, thank you, Jesus.
I doubt that anyone out there with knowledge of the facts is going to deny that it was a miracle.
All right, so we're talking to Joyce and John Smith. By now, he's been resurrected from the dead. He's starting to have life. He's out of the hospital. You mentioned way in the beginning that both of you are people of faith. If this would have went the other way, somebody's going to say, oh, the only reason you still believe in God and believe this is a miracle is because it had a happy ending. If it went the other way, would you still believe in God?
Absolutely. I've made this comment. A lot of people want me to pray for them now, which I'll pray for anybody anytime. I mean, I've always wanted to do that. But I tell people, I've prayed for more people that's died than people that's lived. And that's, I don't say that flippantly, but God is sovereign, and he has a plan for all of us. That was one of the scriptures we hung on to at the hospitals, Jeremiah 29, 11 through 13, which talks about God has a plan for us. And when we seek his face, he will be found. And the November before John had the accident, friends of ours in Michigan had a son, terrific, terrific kid. His name was Mitchell, and he had leukemia. Fighter to the end, but he finally gave up. I can't say gave up the fight. God said, it's enough. I want you to come home. And I will tell you this about this young man. He was 15 when he died, but he did more in his 15 years than a lot of people do their whole entire life. And I believe that God said, okay, son, you've done everything I've asked you to do. Now I'm taking you home. And a lot of people think that if you don't get healed here, then you never got healed. And I don't believe that way. Amen. Heaven is our final resting place. That's where we're headed to. This is just a place to go through. Earth is just, this is where we're here for a purpose, for the kingdom, to bring people to the kingdom. And when we have done what God has asked us to do, then our reward waits before us. And so to think that just because God didn't answer your prayer the way you wanted it, that God isn't God, or that you didn't get your prayer answered, is incorrect. God always answers our prayer. Sometimes they're no. He has a better plan. And so, no, it wouldn't have shaken my faith.
John, what about you? What was your faith like prior to your death and then after your resurrection?
I won't lie, I slipped away. Sure. I've been going to this church my whole life. First Assembly has been my home. And, you know, God has plans for everyone, like Mom just said. And that sometimes includes, you know, losing people. But not losing them as in, you know, in a bad way, but they have to move on for God's plan. And we had just lost, you know, a few pastors here. And I was bitter. I don't like change. I've gotten used to it, but I'm still not a big person to change. And the pastors left, and I quit attending. I met basketball, and that became my earthly idol. I won't lie. I mean, the constant training, the constant games, slowly skipping the routines of, you know, Wednesdays and then, you know, basketball games sometimes falling on Sundays. But Mom was usually good about no games on Sundays. There was usually not that many. But I knew there was a God, but I was always wondering, why did you take these people from my life? And prior to the accident, I slipped away. And my faith was there, but it wasn't as strong as when I was younger. I knew who he was, like I said, but truthfully, I didn't want anything to do with it because I've seen a lot of hurt in my family, some people close to me, and the curiosity of my question was, why do you let bad things happen to good people?
Mm-hmm.
And so I slowly fell away.
So, one, it's amazing how many people have that question.
Mm-hmm.
Why do good things happen to bad people? But two, how did that walk back to God happen after you walk out of the hospital 40 days later? Was it a light bulb, or was there a sense of guilt?
No, sir. It was not an easy process. Immediately, when I was in the hospital, I got up. I was starting to walk. But my dad's older, so I've always seen the older movies, and I always thought of it as a Rocky montage. You know, like, I have to get back to where I was. And for my basketball career, eighth grade, I was fit. I was ready. You know, I wanted that JV spot as a freshman in basketball, so I was like, I got to get back there. And I was getting really frustrated. I couldn't do a push-up. Like, I used to be able to pop out 80, and now I can barely do one. You know, my handwriting used to be amazing. Now it's like scribbles. I was just getting really frustrated. But my goal through the miracle at the beginning wasn't to please anybody. It was to get back to where I was. And again, I fell back into basketball. I wanted that goal. I've always wanted a scholarship. And it took me one summer camp to realize that basketball was not going to be my whole life. It took one person to sit me down and say that, you know, you only get to play basketball for a couple years, but what happens next?
Mm-hmm.
So finally, God was just, he was calling me to something greater, and I was not listening. I didn't want to listen. I didn't want to give up my dream. So he keeps persisting, and finally, basketball comes around, and I'm pretty short, and I get hurt. Bad injury. I'm not saying God gave me this injury, but injuries happen.
Yeah.
And I get in that position, and I'm down in the dumps. You know, I'm not as good as I was, you know, before. I feel like I lost that edge. But, you know, my team needed me, so I come back for one more. And it was against a very good city team, and my other fellow point guard, he was really sick, so it was just me. And this is my second game back, so I've lost some of my cardio from being injured for a while. And after that game, I dive on a ball, knee goes right in the side of my head.
Oh.
Get a concussion. That knocked me out. And I'm sitting in my room, I'm crying. After that game, I cried in my dad's arms for a while. You know, it just the heartbreak of realizing I knew that was the end. But it took me a little while to realize that God had a bigger plan in store.
Mm-hmm.
I decided to give up my frustration and stubbornness to realize what he had for me. And now that I've opened him up to my life, I've realized so many great opportunities that are coming along with it. So many people have contacted me, giving me so many blessings and opportunities to share this. This isn't my story. This is his story. This is God's story.
Amen.
I'm not looking to get money. I'm not looking for profit. I'm not looking for any of that. I'm looking to share this story with the world because turn on the news.
Yeah.
You see everything bad going on. last night something tragic happened. A few weeks ago something else tragic happened. Our world is in need of a hope. Now I'm not saying I'm the hope, I'm saying God's the hope. This story shows that God is still in the miracle working business and is still alive today. Mm-hmm. And that's something I think people have forgotten.
Well, and I think it's interesting too, you know, this whole story of resurrection. And we look at what did he really resurrect. Resurrecting life is actually kind of easy for him. But what he's doing now is actually resurrecting faith.
Yes.
And he resurrected it in you, and he's going to continue to use you to help resurrect it in a generation that we are told continues to die off to faith. So I think there's a plan for that in your life. What do you plan on doing? I mean, you have a what we would call a second lease on life. What does the future look like?
After I got over my stubbornness and realizing basketball wasn't my career, I decided to start getting back into church, and God has brought so many people into my life. I didn't know Pastor Jason before the accident.
Okay.
Frankly, I didn't want to know Pastor Jason before the accident, but now he's becoming one of my great friends. I love him to death. I love his family, his wife, his kids. His son's a good friend of mine. But to answer your question, like I said, he's brought so many people in. They've continued to pray for me, to guide me. But for me, I have began coaching as a basketball coach for the middle school at my school. I hope to finish out high school and then attend a local Christian college to become a pastor and then minor and maybe get a teaching degree to teach middle school math one day.
Very cool.
So I want to get into the church to see where God leads me.
That's amazing. That's amazing, and it's actually a great segue because we're going to have that pastor on the show right after this.
The doctors had gone from that evening saying, man, there's really not much hope, to, man, we're starting to see incredible change already.
So it was a very emotional time. Everybody was crying, including me. It was just an amazing feeling. I just couldn't believe that I was a part of that.
It's truly a miracle that I'm alive, really, and I thank God every time I hear a new piece to what happened. I think it's a way to prove that he's still out there, he's still alive.
This is a testament that we really are exceptional healers and we can provide the best care to our patients. We did reveal the healing presence of God.
The fact that we had super doctors and super nurses. I mean, I can't even say enough about the doctors and the nurses in the ICU. They were phenomenal. God sent, as far as I was concerned, caring, loving, worrying about John.
I truly believe in my 39 years of experience in these types of rescues, this was truly a series of small miracles that have occurred. It occurred in that water with the firefighters. It occurred here at St. Joe's West. It occurred back at Cardinal Glennon, and the results are what we see that occurred when John walked out of Cardinal Glennon, a fine, healthy young teen.
All right, welcome back. So this story that you've heard, it's been turned into a book that you just absolutely have to get because there's no way we can cover the entirety of this story in this short interview. So get The Impossible. I love how it's played out, The Impossible Possible. It's also being turned into a movie. So definitely just tell everybody about this story because it brings hope. And part of that story actually includes our next guest who's sitting next to you, Jason Noble. You're the pastor that he didn't really like.
That's right. And, you know, I'd been here about 6 months when I got the call from John and got the call from the hospital that he was there. And so at that point, I was on my way as quick as I could get there. You know, even though I didn't really know John that well, still getting to learn the congregation, I just had a sense, you know, that it was, I needed to be there. And his parents were asking for me. I'd kind of waited for a little while. I didn't go to the first hospital because I wanted to kind of find out the scoop. We were getting a little bit of really just kind of snippets of information. But I got a call from my wife, who was down at the hospital, who said, hey, they need their pastor. So I was on my way.
One of the things that was referenced earlier by Joyce was there was this story about John opening up his eyes.
Yeah.
And tell us
so,
that.
At about 4 o'clock, I arrived at Cardinal Glennon to Joyce walking out of the room after she had just had that pretty strong conversation with Dr. Garrett. And she basically told me, she said, he has rudimentary brain function, kind of told me the story about what was happening, said that the doctor was saying he does not think John was going to make it more than 24 hours. And so at that point, we were not going to accept anything but life. And I think we even said we are speaking life over this situation. We are not going to speak death over John. And Joyce basically said, and there's no other option. And I agreed with her. I said, this boy's going to make it. And so at that point, we walked into the room where John was at, gathered a couple of other pastors, and walked in. And John was in tough shape. I mean, it pretty much took my breath away as I was standing there. And we started praying. We prayed two specific things because we knew his lungs were an issue and okay. his brain were an issue, the brain and lungs. And we started praying, Lord, bring back, breathe that breath of air into John's lungs like you did Adam that we read about in Scripture. You're the breath of life. Breathe that in. As I was praying, I turned around and I saw two angels in the room that were literally floor to ceiling. It was interesting because I'd seen those two angels in a room about 3 years earlier when I'd gotten called to a lady in Port Angeles, Washington, who was 85 years old, was dying, had about 15 minutes to live. She didn't know the Lord. So I went down to that room and I got down and whispered in this lady's ear. And I mean, stats were horrible. It was in tough shape. She was in tough shape. And I said, if you want to accept Jesus into your heart, now's your time. You're standing on the edge of eternity. Mm-hmm. And I said, squeeze my hand. And I felt this little squeeze. And as I felt that squeeze, I turned around and I saw the same two angels in the room.
Wow.
The same exact two angels. And so within a couple minutes, it started to see color come back into her legs. And within 15 minutes, she was full color, full stats. The nurses were amazed. I mean, just amazed. And she wakes up and says, I've given my heart to the Lord. Like my life is, I've given it to Jesus. And so with that, I knew I'd seen those two angels before.
Wow.
And there's no formula for healing, but I just had a feeling like the angels were on guard. And at that moment, back in John's room, he breathed over the breathing machine that he was on and his eyes opened. And I go, okay, this is, I mean, kind of shoulders come off the bed. You know, I mean, and there was no way. Of course, the nurse was trying to talk it off like, oh, that's kind of what they do when they're on the respirator and, you know, whatever. So we're going, well, we're not accepting it. I mean, like, we're going to keep praying. So then we started to pray, Lord, you know, restore his brain. And over his head, I saw like a millions of rainbow colors. And God was like, kind of putting him back together again. And after that, a few moments of just seeing that, he opened his eyes full. And shoulders kind of came off the bed for sure. I mean, and at that point I knew he was completely fine. He was completely fine. And it was so interesting how that was confirmed. We had gotten a call later on that week where a lady had said, was there two angels in John's room on Monday night? And we're like, yeah, there was. She said, I saw them. And they were the same two angels that were in my room when I was 16 and I was supposed to die. And then wow. with the colors over his head, Joyce had prayed for a man 2 years earlier that had throat cancer, and her husband was up singing in the choir, and Joyce had seen those colors over his head, and he was completely healed from throat cancer. So you just wow. see those confirmations of God at work, and at that point, we knew he was going to be okay.
Now, we hear a lot about, you know, these miracle-working pastors, and I'm not going to name names, but we always hear, well, where's the medical proof? They don't show medical records. Here we have a situation where you're dead for like an hour. You're in a coma. We're being told you're never going to be more than a vegetable at most. Really just prepare for you to die. This is a miracle.
I think it's one of the most medically documented miracles mm-hmm. that you find in this century so far.
We have a whole chapter of just what was medically wrong with me and should have killed me in the book.
10 different things. I mean, yeah. once he woke up, there was still 10 different things that, I mean, even that night, in the hospital, the doctor said, I mean, there was like, you know, his organs were all in catastrophic failure. His kidneys had shut down. His liver was shutting down. I mean, like, if not one thing, I mean, you know, if the drowning wasn't going to kill him, there was 10 other things that should have. And the doctors were just shocked. I mean, the fact that his lungs were filled with lake water. They say that lake water is some of the nastiest water in the Midwest. And literally as he, you know, and the other thing about that drowning that was so interesting is usually when you go down, you don't take on a lot of water. The way that John went down, it filled his lungs with water. I mean, and that's wow. why they have that story. But as they were looking, he had spiked a fever and they were thinking, well, man, is it his lungs? Is there an infection? You know, and the doctors were saying that, hey, you know, even everyone in the Midwest would not have sterile lungs. I mean, just by the pesticides and all of that, they did the test. Lungs were completely sterile. But it was interesting, every time we got that a report of, hey, this is what's wrong, we would send out Facebook prayer requests that would go around the world. And literally within an hour, the situation was resolved.
Well, and what amazes me too is not only did you get healed, the rate at which it happened. We're not talking like 7 years in. We're like 7 days, or 7 days you're good, 7 more days you're out, 40 days no more doctors ever. Like, this was insanely fast.
It was. And what I was so honored is I got to be by his bedside. I was there about 18 hours a day for the first 7 days.
Wow.
And my job, I really felt, I walked in the next morning after it first happened, and I look at John, and I go, John, do you want me to stay with you? And he wasn't fully awake at that point, but big tears rolled down his eyes. And I knew at that point, like, you know what? I'm here. And
so God just spoke to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, all of a sudden he started to like me.
Took time.
And so, you know, it's so interesting. We call it a tapestry of miracles. And it's so interesting to see everything was so within minutes. Like in the ice, when he had fallen through the ice, the paramedics and the firefighters told us that he was within 1 minute of it becoming a recovery. I mean, literally. And as that hole in the ice opened up, he was literally so close that any kind of wave could have pushed him underneath and he would have been gone. Mm-hmm. I mean, so literally everything was within seconds of how God put it together. When he got to the hospital, Dr. Garrett is the area expert on hypothermia and drowning.
Who wasn't supposed to be there.
He wasn't supposed to be there. And now he's looked for 2 years. Is there another case in the world like John? Because that year at Cardinal Glennon, they had lost 6 more kids from drowning.
Wow.
And he said they have not been able, they found one case in Norway of a lady that went in head first and she was in for 15 minutes and it's been about 9 months of recovery and she's still at about 80%. So they cannot find another case like John's in the world. I mean, and so you just look at all of that and it's just so amazing.
Yeah.
It's like God did it so well that it would be a story for the world.
Mm-hmm. So you're still going to have people who doubt.
Yes.
Why? Is it a hardening of the heart? Is it, I mean, obviously they don't want to believe science. They don't want to believe anything, really. They don't want to believe.
Yeah.
Why?
Well, I think that it is an impossibility, you know? I mean, and as you read through that book, I don't know how you couldn't believe. You know, I mean, as you look at all of the things, it wasn't like one thing got fixed. It was multiple things that God did. And I think he just said, okay, for those people that don't believe, I'm not going to do it just once.
Yeah.
I'm going to do it every time you turn around. And the fact that he walks out of the hospital 14 days later, you know, I mean, after this accident is just amazing, you know.
Well, I feel like we could do this interview for days and not scratch
the surface. So I think the book is so, I mean, you got to get into it.
They have to get the book. People have to get the book. And it's going to be turned into a film as well.
It is. 20th Century Fox and Devon Franklin.
Okay.
Where it looks like it will be in around Christmas of 2018.
Okay.
He produced Miracles from Heaven and Heaven
oh,
is
sure,
for Real. So it goes right along with that story. And his goal is to share with the world this testimony.
Well, I want to thank all three of you for sharing this testimony with us today. And hopefully we can get this out to more people. This is absolutely amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you.